what is cost? Well, depending on who you ask, cost can be the most important or the least important consideration for a business case, and all manner in between. Sometimes matters of cost can be intimidating because of the terminology, or maybe you just feel uncomfortable talking about money. Well, there's really no getting around it when creating a business case. In this module, we're going to be talking about some of the economic aspects typically involved in developing a cloud business case. We'll cover the important distinction between cost and value. You're going to learn about total cost of ownership and how we can calculate it, or at least approximate it. We'll also learn about how the cloud can influence our business expenses. When most people talk about cost, they're usually referring to how much money it takes to acquire something. Now, as we know, cost isn't limited to money. It can be described in terms of time or resources. Usually, cost is a number, a figure that most people try to minimize, but cost itself is really one-dimensional. If I were to charge you 100 euro for this box, is that a good deal? Well, you don't know because you don't know what's in the box. So cost alone isn't very useful. We also have to consider the benefits that we get in exchange for that cost. In economic terms, we call this utility. And it's this ratio between cost and utility that describes the value of something. Now, because utility is often very subjective and changes from situation to situation, the value is situational as well. And this is why building a cloud business case, indeed any business case, is not a one-size-fits-all prospect. When evaluating cloud adoption, most business cases will compare our current state to a potential cloud-based future state. And one way people try to do this is by building a total cost of ownership, or TCO. Now, yes, if I ran the world, I'd call it a total value of ownership, but people call it a TCO, so we'll just go with it. Let's look at an example. A basic TCO will describe the costs that I call the low-hanging fruit. And those are usually infrastructure and software costs. They're easy to get to because we can just look at our invoices for that. But if we stop there, we're not going to have a very complete picture. We also need to include things like power and cooling and fire protection. Because our company might be in a regulated industry, we have to maintain certifications. So we might have to pay an auditor to come in and audit our facilities every so often to make sure that we have the proper security and safety measures in place. We also have labor costs. These are the people that keep everything running. Now, all these things we can put into an operational cost bucket as they relate to just keeping the lights on, business as usual. Now, on the cloud side of things, all those facility and equipment charges are covered for us in the cost of the resource. Many times, the software licenses are included as well. In the cloud architecture module, we covered some of the common migration strategies, and depending on which one we choose, we can formulate an approximate operational cost for our cloudified landscape. All the major cloud providers offer cost calculators to help out with this. Okay, now we have our operational costs to describe our current state and our potential future state. We're good, right? No. We have many more things to consider. Migrating systems to the cloud isn't without its costs as well. Think about all the things that you're going to have to do above and beyond just business as usual. We might need to purchase some new tools to help with that migration. Maybe we need to bring in a consultant to help us design our new cloud-based architecture properly. We'll certainly want to train our staff on how to use the cloud efficiently. We might need to figure in the cost to buy out contracts or break leases if we don't need those services or facilities anymore. If downtime means lost revenue for us, we might need to include some allowance for any required planned downtime as we're migrating those systems to the cloud. Now we're starting to get a better picture of things, but we're not done yet. We also have a host of intangible items that we should consider that will impact our TCO. We might be able to avoid costs. For example, archiving to the cloud is a way that we can avoid having to buy an expensive on-site storage system. In the cloud, we might be able to offer self-service options to our staff, which could reduce the number of touches that it takes to get stuff done, which should have some worth to us. Maybe our existing business systems can only run processes overnight, while a cloud-based solution could allow us to do things in real time. Now, many companies find that their overall data security increases once they move to the cloud, and we'll cover this in more detail in the governance and security module, but that should have some value to the organization as well. Then we have agility. There are many examples of companies prototyping and deploying new capabilities in a matter of hours or days just by assembling some ready-made cloud services. What's that worth? What is it worth if our competitor has that ability and we don't? There's probably some cost of inaction in that case. Think about retaining and attracting employees. Cloud skills are in high demand now, so trying to hire a skilled engineer will certainly have a cost. On the retention side, by allowing our employees to develop those in-demand skills, will that reduce employee turnover or increase employee engagement? These things have value too. And hopefully, we're beyond that whole, if I train my employees, they will leave nonsense. Providing good training resources for your employees can be one of the biggest and best returns for your money during a cloud adoption. Now, these intangibles will probably be pretty challenging to distill into a cost figure, but they are impactful parts of our TCO equation. Superficial TCO exercises miss these things, but they are how your TCO can provide a better, complete picture and illustrate to decision makers that you're thinking strategically. Two terms that you might hear about commonly are capital expenses and operational expenses, or CapEx and OpEx, as the cool kids call them. Let me first give you an example of a capital expense or a CapEx model. Now, the idea behind a capital asset is that a company can buy something with the expectation that it will keep doing what it's supposed to do for several years. Then, when its useful life is over, they would probably buy something new to replace it. Now, useful life is an interesting term, and it's usually governed by depreciation schedules. Depreciation is a way that a company can account for the declining value of that asset over multiple years. However, depreciation is a non-cash activity. It's more for tax and accounting purposes. I still have to drop a big load of cash up front or sign some long-term payment contract to actually pay off that whole asset. Now, traditionally, IT equipment was treated as a capital asset. Back in the day, to make use of the technology, you had to physically own it. This concept of using computers in some faraway location just wasn't very common or cost-effective. Second, the technology was very expensive and involved large outlays of money that would usually require many approvals across levels of the organization. So I, as a CIO, may only get the opportunity to ask for new equipment every few years, usually defined by a depreciation schedule. I'd need to somehow predict what my other internal business partners are gonna need, at least until my next opportunity to buy, which is a few years down the road. Most of the time, that prediction is just a complete guess. My internal business partners might barely know what the next 12 months holds, let alone the next 5 years. And so many things can change, like economic markets, competition, regulation, technology advancements, and so on. If I guess too high, I'll have unused resources and I just wasted company money. If I guess too low, I might have to make some emergency purchases and miss out on economies of scale. Now, as perilous as this sounds, it was and still is how things are done in many companies. But with the advent of faster data communication lines and companies leaning into the pay-as-you-go business model, this provides us with a very special opportunity. Moving to an operational expense or an OpEx model for our IT resources. Operational expenses are variable costs required to operate our business. And rather than buying everything up front and hoping I bought the right amount, I can just buy stuff as I need it and return it when I don't need it. I can reevaluate my needs every hour or minute versus every few years. And our computing costs can vary over time in relation to our business operations. And this has some huge implications. We can base our IT costs on actual demand versus reading the tea leaves in some rough forecast. We don't need to tie up piles of cash building out a data center. We can get access to the latest technology versus being stuck with some obsolete equipment. The cloud has truly flipped the competitive landscape. Small startups can and do compete head-to-head with mega corporations. This platform, A-Cloud Guru, is a perfect case study on that point. Don't go jumping to the conclusion that CapEx is bad and OpEx is good. CapEx approaches can be situationally better. One example is if a company wanted to increase their book value with more assets on their balance sheet. Or maybe a company's near-term cost to capital is far less than what they expect it to be in the future. These are the nuances of corporate finance and accounting. And if you don't have a finance background, I would strongly encourage you to partner with somebody in your finance department when building this business case. Given their perspective, they might really help you pull together a more complete value picture, especially for some of those intangible items that we talked about. Plus, they may help temper any sort of inherent bias or blind spot you might have around this cost and value topic. But above all, be sure your business case tells the story in terms of value and not just cost.